I welcome you, ladies and gentlemen, who are just coming into the room. I will ask that you come and start taking in seats, that we have several tables that can still fill towards the front and center of the room. Do not be shy. Thank you. And we are so glad that you are here for our evening panel discussion. It is wonderful to see how many of you have chosen to sit towards the front and center, and I want to personally thank you and show my appreciation. For those of you who have just coming in, we ask you to come towards the front and center and flanks such that we can have a full audience as we enter our evening panel discussion. Thank you. Welcome for those who are just coming in. We encourage you to come towards the front and the center and our flanks to fill in our tables for our evening discussion. Do not be shy. Thank you so much for coming, and thank you for taking your seats. We will be starting shortly. Welcome to those who are just coming in. I encourage you to come towards the front and your flanks to fill in our sections as we are about to begin our evening panel discussion. Thank you for coming, and we look forward to you enjoying this evening panel discussion. Welcome to those who have just come in. I kindly ask you to come and fill in our tables towards the center and our flanks as we get ready to begin our evening panel discussion. We will be starting very shortly. Thank you. We will now begin our evening event. If you are coming in, I kindly ask you to take your seats. There are still seats available towards the front. I encourage you to come forward. We will now be beginning our session. For those that are coming after we begin, please just quietly take your seats. Thank you very much, and I hope you enjoy tonight's festivities. Our master of ceremony will be Tracy Edwards. I will ask you to come to the podium. The floor is yours.
Good evening, everyone. Good evening, good evening, good evening. Aw, thank you. Good evening, everyone. If you can, take your seats and come to the front if possible. We're gonna go ahead and get started. Hi, everyone. My name is Tracy Edwards. I am your Vice Student Representative, as well as your Student Council member. We are going to tonight having a panel, quantum panel discussion from earlier today. We want to continue that discussion tonight. I want to ask all of my panelists to please come to the front table so we can get started. Dr. Nadia Mason, Dr. Michelle Lawley, and Dr. Thomas Searle, so you can come to the front, please. Take a few more moments to eat, meet your neighbor, and then we'll get started. Thank you. Thank you.
Ah, got it. I'm good. Can I translate this? Is it crazy to translate this?
Good evening, everyone. Good evening, everyone. Thank you. I'm glad to see you all back here tonight, and we would like to get started with our next session. If you all have noticed, we have made a little bit of a transition. We're going from a plenary session to a quantum panel, so you can get to hear from many experts in the quantum field. Another housekeeping announcement, we want to take school group photos tonight. So after tonight's panel, if you guys can kind of stay put, we're going to call up schools group by group, come to the stage, take a nice picture, and post it on social media to say thanks for coming. Next, I want to introduce our moderator for the evening, Dr. Bill Wilson. Dr. Bill Wilson earned a Bachelor's of Science in Chemistry from St. Joseph's University and a PhD in physical chemistry at Stanford University. In 2001, Dr. Wilson became a founder and chief science officer in the Phase Technologies, developing high performance optical data storage. In 2009, Bill moved to academia, serving as associate research professor in material science and engineering, and the associate director of the Integrated Imaging Center at Johns Hopkins University. In 2011, Bill moved to the Faculty of the Materials Science and Engineering Department and the directorship of the Central Research Facilities at the Materials Research Laboratories at the University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign. In 2015, Dr. Wilson accepted the executive directorship at the Center for Nanoscale Systems at Harvard University. Dr. Wilson has published over 100 papers, co-authored a book on holographic data storage, and has been granted more than 30 US and international patents. Please welcome our moderator for the evening, Dr. Bill Wilson.
Thank you. So what we've kind of decided to do is actually something very naturally quantum. What we're doing is we're creating a coherent superposition of the plenary talk and the panel from this afternoon. Okay, and so I'm going to introduce our panelists. The first, of course, will be Dr. Nadia Mason. Nadia is the Dean of the Pritzker School of Engineering at the University of Chicago. Her research focus has been in experimental studies of transport and quantum materials, is currently a member of the President's National Quantum Initiative Advisory Committee. She's a member of the National Academy of Sciences, the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, and has been recognized for her work with awards, including the APS Maria Goldport Mayer Award and the 2019 Boucher Prize. You all three came up at once. Okay, our second panelist is Dr. Michelle Lally. Dr. Lally is an advanced laser scientist at Quantinuum. She aids in design and construction of essential optical systems for state-of-the-art quantum computers. She completed her PhD in physics at Louisiana State University and has the honor of being the first Black woman to do so. And of course, when she's not wrangling photons, you can find her practicing the violin. And our final panelist needs no introduction. Is Dr. Thomas Searles, an associate professor in electrical and computer engineering at the University of Illinois at Chicago. He was recently a Martin Luther King visiting professor at MIT and serves as the director for the IBM HBCU Quantum Centers. Thomas received his PhD in applied physics from Rice University. Okay. And so I think we're going to open with just kind of a brief 3 to 5 minute, and I don't have the time you do, I?
No.
Read the 3 to 5 minute just overview of the work that you're currently doing in quantum information science.
Can we just take a quantum time transfer, just assume you've already been introduced?
No. No, we don't. This system does not have time reversal symmetry.
Let's talk about ourselves.
I can start if you guys want to. Yeah, I'm very excited to talk about this. So the way that we're going to do it is the most recent stuff. So typically, I'm working with quantum computing and then also quantum communications, quantum networking. Our most recent paper is on the cover of the ABS Quantum Science. Please cite us. It's all good.
Talk about it.
And for that one, we actually are taking the West African game in Kala. Shout out to Musa. Where's Musa at? Me and Musa talked about this idea in the pandemic, but this idea of representing an optical lattice of bosons with the West African game in Kala and developing strategies for quantum state tomography. So we're excited about that. But just in general, we're working with classical machine learning in the quantum space and quantum state tomography.
So I was directed to tell you all about what I work and what I work on in quantum information science. But in the position that I'm in, I cannot tell you anything that I do. However, I thought that I could let you know what I kind of came out of graduate school with. So I will say about Quantinuum, I do work in the lasers and electro optics, and I do support via optical setups our quantum computers. And that's probably about the extent of what I'll say about Quantinuum, other than we do have internships and permanent positions, so make sure you apply. So I came out of Louisiana State, and my research was actually in high dimensional optical quantum states for communication and cryptographic protocols. I did classical and quantum optics. So I worked on quantum random walks in multimode fibers, where we were taking orbital angular momentum modes of light, sending it through a multimode fiber, scrambling messages as it were, and then doing some kind of Fock state or number state basis time bend correlations for quantum random walks, trying to show quantum randomness. And I was just at the point where I was gonna run it through kind of the NIST diehard test for randomness and going a bit further when it was time to go and graduate. And so I said, you don't have to tell me twice. I'm out of here, but I remember one of the important things, and since there are a lot of students and students in the audience, one of the important things that I just wanted to point out to you all is that I did work in quantum information science, but I also did a lot of work with equity. And so if you're working on that in your department, please keep going strong. It's tough to do as a graduate student, but it was something that I did, and now I'm proud to look back on it. And it actually has had an impact not only on the department, but other students that were in my quantum photonics group. So again, for the most part, just worked on high dimensional states of light. Squeeze light, I worked with LIGO for a bit. So when they were making the gravitational centers more sensitive, I helped with that as well. I worked in the lab that kind of had access and promoted that particular technology on LIGO. But yeah, to the students in the audience, my message is always advocate for yourself, advocate for others, and work in quantum.
Okay, good evening, everyone. First, apologies that the plenary didn't work out today. We will do that another time, hopefully. But I will tell you that one of my main points of the talk I was going to give was going to be about leading with values, leading your life with values, making decisions based on your own values, and making sure that that's what drives you, not what other people say, not what you think you should do, but based on what your values tell you, what you believe in, what's important to you, what you're interested in. Which leads me to my segue of why I was interested in physics, and probably like many of you, I was interested in it because I just wanted to understand the way the world worked. I loved thinking of how you could go from very simple laws to understanding macroscopic behavior. And when I went to graduate school, this is what I wanted to know more about. How do you go from the microscopic to the macroscopic? I ended up thinking about electrons and materials, in particular about superconductivity, which is a way that you have individual electrons that work together to create a resistance-free state. That was just intellectually interesting to me. I wanted to learn more about it. It turns out that's also part of quantum. So, you know, as with many, I was driven by interest, and I ended up in a field that superconductivity by itself is very interesting, but it's also the basis for the probably most prominent qubits, which are superconducting qubits, which again have two electrons which are paired up and entangled. So probably many of you already work in quantum. We live in a quantum world. You follow your interests, you work on electrons, you work on particles, you work on entanglement, and you are already doing quantum. So if you think it's a foreign field, it's not. You know it, you're probably doing it partially already. For me, I started out just doing basic superconductivity research, and as quantum became more interesting and exciting to both my lab and the outside world, we started thinking more about qubits and about unusual sorts of qubits that we could study from the quantum materials perspective, like topological materials. So that's my personal research. I think the first question is, what is our work in quantum? I want to mention that I'm also now dean of an engineering school where one of our three themes is quantum engineering. And so we're organized not by departments, but by just problems that are out there in society. And one of three is quantum, because we really think that that's the biggest topic for the future. You know, that we're not limited by departments. We don't have to do any other field, but we can, I don't want to disparage anyone, but you know, we can look forward, and quantum is, in all its various aspects, which we'll talk about, is the future. And so we've organized our entire school hiring faculty, not into physics, not into computer science, not into mechanical engineering, but into quantum engineering. And so I think that's the way we're going to move forward. We have a major in quantum engineering, we have a master's in quantum engineering, and there are companies beating down our doors to hire our students. The last thing I'll say is I'm also involved in the National Quantum Initiative. I'm on the advisory board for that. That is a, what is the number, $2.5 billion investment by the US government in quantum. $2.5 billion over 5 years. That's how big it is. And it's going to be renewed, right? That's $5 billion in this one area of quantum. And that's to set up quantum centers, to train a quantum workforce, to just build industry academic relationships, to build this whole quantum ecosystem. And you can bet if the US government is investing $5 billion in one area of research, that's the future. So I'm involved in all of those things, and I'm really excited to be able to talk to you more about that.
Thank you. So the first question I'll ask is, officially, I guess this is really the second question, is we all know folks have been studying quantum for 100 years. right? In fact, I often say that nano was quantum before quantum was cool, right? And so the interesting question is, why is it making news now? What's different about quantum information science and quantum engineering in general from the way we have traditionally thought about quantum mechanics?
So I was actually looking forward to this question. I think the reason why it's making waves now, there's a two-part to this. So one, it's making waves now because now we have the technology, right? Even as recent as maybe 3 or 4 decades ago, right? We did not have the technology to work on what we're doing now. Now we have fast switch components, right? Now we have electronic components that can actually handle the images that we're trying to take, that can capture things moving at the speed that we're trying to capture. So we now have the technology. Another part of that is a little bit of the sensation of quantum, so the sensationalization of the field. We are doing very exciting work. And once you start to get buzzy words like, oh, quantum computers can break RSA encryption. Wait, aren't our government systems backed by RSA encryption? You know, you start to have people interested in what these quantum things can do from a variety of, or from a myriad of levels. So one could be security, one could be higher capacity communication, you know, the ideal quantum internet, as it were. These are things that make people very excited. And we are approaching this in the field from, I'd say, components, hardware, and software. And each of those areas has exciting research going on that people like to talk about and that they want to work in these areas. So again, even as 40 years ago, we didn't have the infrastructure. Now we have the infrastructure, and now the people are starting to see what quantum can do from published research in academia, national governments, and industry. It is definitely starting to get the ball rolling, and what we thought would be lifetimes away is now within maybe the next few decades, right? Some people are even a bit more optimistic than that, and I think that's why we're now seeing the hype around quantum.
And then I'll say something in a little bit different way. So in Symmetry Magazine, there was an article that was called Black in Quantum. And my guy Charles Brown was featured heavily in that article. I just had a little line, you know what I'm saying? I was just in there a little bit. But one of the interesting things I wanted to bring across by this, why that the second or third, please people don't murder me, but Elmer Imes worked on atomic spectra. And he had a very, very prominent career at an HBCU in this space. Another person is the name of Herman Branson. He was an X-ray crystallographer, but very much quantum at the time, type of scenario. You fast forward a little bit, Morehouse is in the house. Where's Morehouse at? Y'all in here somewhere. One of the dopest physicists ever to come out of Morehouse is a dude named Walter Massey. His work was on quantum spin liquids. I read those papers now, and it's like cool to read it, right? So I say that to say that this is just a natural order of what Black people are doing in science. And we're following in the same way that you had quantum 1.0 that everybody uses. Lasers, LEDs, MRIs, your phone, all of that is from the first quantum wave. Now we have an opportunity to educate so many more Black students in this space. And the biggest thing that changes is that you can have people like Dr. Lolly that can go get a job. For real. I graduated in 2011. My thing was on nanotubes. Like, we had kind of two options. Go to the government, maybe get an academic job, or go get some oil money, right? That was it. Now there's a $1 billion industry centered in Chicago that each of y'all will, like, it'll transform not only scientifically, but it can change like the trajectory of your family. And that's really where it's at.
So I'm gonna take a step even further back and take a little bit of a pedagogical approach, because this is how I think. You know, how many people here have taken quantum or are going to take quantum in class? Like everyone, right? So you know, we've studied quantum, and as you said, we use quantum. MRIs are quantum, and you know, semiconductors and the transistors are quantum. So when we talk about quantum devices today, we don't mean just using quantum mechanics. What people are really talking about is using the coherent properties of atoms or electrons or particles, using the coherent properties and manipulating those for applications. So I just want to be clear, because I think it's important to distinguish between these. We live in a quantum world. You guys know quantum, but this is something a little bit new. So when you think about, you know, particles, atoms, electrons, you know, if you think about particle wave functions, I'm sorry to get technical, I know it's dinner, but okay, just very simple. A wave function has an amplitude and a
phase.
Thank you. And a phase, right? A phase. A wave function has an amplitude and a phase. And when we talk about being coherent, what we mean is maintaining that phase, right? And so if you have two particles, do they have the same phase? If they have the same phase, you can separate them, right? They're basically the same wave, and you can pull them apart. You can do all these crazy things we hear about in quantum, like quantum communication, where things are basically the same object with the same phase, and even if they're physically separated, they interact with each other, right? That's quantum communication. You can make quantum computers because a quantum bit is an entangled particle that has a single phase. And so that's the really cool new thing about it, is that what we discovered is not what quantum is, but to how to maintain phase for applications. And so now we're moving from an MRI where we use just atoms, we use transitions, to something where we're doing these spooky communication at a distance, or using qubits, quantum bits, to do processing that's, you know, massively more parallel than what we could do before. So the idea is somewhat new, but the ability to maintain that phase also requires that we separate it from the environment, right? Anything will dephase, and that's the biggest challenge in quantum, most quantum things, have you heard of like lack of decoherence and dephasing? That means you're losing that new type of coherent quantum property in your applications, and that's the biggest challenge, but it's also the biggest opportunity. And that's really, really exciting to see the strides that have made in that direction, because if you had asked me 10 years ago whether we could maintain quantum coherence for computing, for sensing applications, for all these things that we do today, I would have said no way. But there's been amazing scientific and technological strides there, and we're really in a new, different sort of quantum world now. That's exciting.
Thank you. So, I mean, most of the folks here, I'm sure, have heard a lot of the buzz about quantum computation, right? But that's not the only quantum information science application. Can you guys kind of walk through some of the other potential applications for a lot of these technologies?
So I was just in Singapore, and that's not a flex. It's like in the context of this question. So right now in Singapore, they have point-to-point quantum key distribution all over the city. Like, that's just crazy to me. Yeah, and then the really dope part is that Alex Sling, that I was there visiting, he actually works with, anybody work on CubeSats? All right, so these are small satellites, low Earth orbit. So he had two photon entanglement Bell state measurements talking from the ground station that he built outside his lab to the satellite that's there. Now, the really dope thing that's happening is that we're putting one in Chicago. We're putting one in Louisiana.
Yeah.
We want to put one in Atlanta, right? That's one of the things. Now, what can you do with that? Well, one of the biggest things on quantum is measurement. It's one of the key concepts in learning. You measure a particle, what happens? The wave function collapses. That's a big, big problem, but there's also applications that you can use for that. With respect to secure messages are things that I'm interested in, like game theory. What happens when, if you have a prisoner's dilemma, if I snitch, there's a 50% chance that you won't tell on me, right? But if we're entangled, that problem is crazy. Right? And I'll stop talking. I'll nerd out.
No. Why are you handing me the microphone?
I don't know what to talk about.
So first, I know, okay, you say everyone knows about quantum computing, but We know, I don't know, I feel like we know about quantum computing, but we don't quite know what it's good for yet.
Yes.
And by we, I mean everyone. Everyone, not just like you or us, but we're still kind of waiting for some applications. So even things like quantum computing, maybe they'll solve, you know, protein folding and unfolding, which will allow us to sort of cure diseases in a way that we could never do before. And maybe they'll solve these traveling salesman problems that couldn't be solved, and that will allow us to, AI solutions, for example, which we need more. We don't need more of that anyway, but, you know, cooler things. But the interesting thing about it is that there aren't, people are still trying to come up with applications. And this is one of the things we'll talk about later, that, you know, what are the jobs out there? One of them is figuring out what this amazing new technology could be used for. It's like in the 20s, when they were first splitting the atom, they were just thinking, this is cool, right? Atom has structure. Look what's going on. And yet, you know, years later, it can be used for energy and more nefarious purposes, but mostly for energy as far as we're concerned. So, you know, there, you don't, well, but for the good and the bad, and this is part of it, that these have all sorts of potential applications, and you want to be able to understand it, to control it, to contribute to that process, and there's opportunities out there. I want to mention one other thing, which is something that I just learned about. It's an atom interferometer. So, you know, again, an atom interferometer, we talked about coherence. That's something that keeps coherence. And this is a technology that's just been developed. I mean, we know about GPS. GPS is intrinsically quantum. It allows us, you know, that's what allows us to be tracked everywhere, but track others. But an atom interferometer, but GPS doesn't work underwater, for example, or under the earth, underground. And so how do you keep track if you're a submarine, or if you're under, you know, in a tunnel, or, okay, these are all bad examples, but, you know, if you want to keep track in places that you can't go to with GPS, you need a dedicated way of keeping track. And atom interferometry is a technique that's just been developed that could allow you to do that. And so there's all sorts of opportunities in different realms of sensing and interferometry and computing that we're just now figuring out what their power is and what their uses are. So it's really super exciting.
So I was going to go another route, and is that we have, so Nadia just mentioned sensing, and that was the route that I was going to go, is that you are now talking about, you know, it's been proven that we can do kind of standard quantum limit sensing. LIGO does that, right? That's how they, it's a gravitational sensor that they're doing with their interferometer, as it were. They're basically doing gravitational high super sensitivity, if you will. But sensing, so you have organizations like NASA that are trying to do, very deep space communication. They're trying to extend their reach via a very long baseline interferometry. And so they want to make sure that these interferometers are in a position where they can have even that much more sensitivity. So they're working on these quantum sensors. Also, you have atomic clock synchronization. Nadia was also just talking about like GPS. We don't even have to go underwater. What about if it's just a cloudy day? What if it's a storm going on outside, right? The GPS sensitivity and sensor or sensing has been getting better over the years. But even Thomas brought this up with something that's new and exciting, which are quantum networks. How do you allow for long distance quantum communication when you're talking about attenuation at around 100 kilometers for fiber optic signals? And now you're talking about quantum relays, right? You can't just amplify a signal in a fiber like you can do classically when you're dealing with quantum systems, because you cannot clone unknown quantum states, right? So what do? You have to build these quantum repeaters to basically relay your information with high fidelity at high rates. And that's a challenging problem. But now, what if you actually want to have a satellite send that information down? Well, now you're dealing with atmospheric effects. You're dealing with slant path effects. You're actually dealing now with relativity. You know, you have two rotational bodies. How do you make sure that each thing is in line of sight? So these are some more of the sensing technologies, the communication technologies, and quantum repeaters are basically quantum processors. So it's so very much interweaved, so very much overlapped. I had several students ask me, you know, how do I get into this? What do I do? There's so many. You're coming from computer engineering, mechanical engineering, electrical engineering, optics, physics, computer science, math. there are so many different ways and so many different groups. It's interdisciplinary. And not to belabor the point, but it goes into what are we actually working on? What are some of these technology, quantum chemistry, right? Simulating multi-particle systems at the quantum level with high fidelity. That is a hard, but that's all, you know, at one point in time, it was intractable. Now people are doing it, right? And so not to say that every intractable problem can be solved, you know, we're still working on the traveling salesman. However, some people may think that it can't be solved. However, with that being said, these are the technologies to look into. So if you're saying, oh, well, I have to work in physics or I have to do this. No, I talked to a young lady who's, if she doesn't mind me putting her business out there, she is thinking of doing a PhD, MD, with neuroscience and quantum technologies. You just have to think it. It is out there and you can find it. And these are the technologies. Find the problems that you want to solve with quantum machine learning. It is out there and you can do it. As Nadia and Thomas have alluded to, there's so much out there that can be done. There's so many new technologies.
Yeah, and the one thing I'll add to that is that the idea of things like a quantum repeater and technologies in those spaces, we're building those devices now. We're building them out of photonics. We're building them out of diamond NV centers. We're actually doing that engineering, making those physical devices. I mean, Amazon has a Tiger team that's developing a quantum network so that they can do distributed classical computing. And all these things are going on, and a ton of investment is currently being made. And so before I open the floor to the students, I want you guys to make your best pitch on why your life would have no meaning unless you work in this space.
I'm the wrong person to ask that. man, I don't know, guys. It's like, I think about some things like this all the time. Like the Mancala paper, again, shout out to that. I didn't think it was gonna get on the cover. That was like one paper that I didn't care about it because it didn't have any implication on tenure. The person had already left that was a postdoc, so it was like a graduation timeline. I really just liked the science in the paper, right? So that's one aspect of it. I'm doing the science of my life right now. The other aspect is I'm working with fantastic young people that are better scientists than me. My group happens to be 100% women, and they're all fantastic. And then the last part is like, I mean, you're on the board, but really and truthfully, Cornelius that spoke today, I didn't even know Cornelius was on our scholarship until he came up and walked. I was at Optica at a panel, and he walked up to me. He was like, hey man, you're Thomas Searles, right? I said, I guess so. And he was like, I'm on your scholarship. Thank you. Like that's what it is for me. It's like, again, helping young people to be able to one day sit on stage with these Morehouse polo loafers on. That's it.
Okay, so I mentioned the $5 billion in investment, right? Okay, but seriously, the cutting edge of today is the standard technology of tomorrow. You know, a lot of you guys are in the early stages of your career. Where do you want to be in 10 years? Right? For whatever you choose to do, don't think about what's going on now. Think about what's going to happen. Where are the jobs going to be? Where is this exciting science going to happen? And right now, I think that's quantum. That's the future. So whatever you choose to do, I mean, you're already doing quantum, right? You're here at the Conference of Black Physicists, right? So you're right there. But just remember, you're moving ahead, and moving ahead means the next generation of technology.
So I'm gonna give a pitch for quantum, but really just for physics in general, right? For STEM fields, especially for scholars of color in the fields, but you know, I might be biased towards physics. It is, and actually someone mentioned this earlier, it was at a plenary talk, I feel bad because I can't remember, but they're gonna know who they are because it affected me. When you are, living in this world, it is natural to do physics. It is natural to want to explore your space. For some of us, we have the story of we looked up at the stars and that was it, astronomy and cosmology, right? For me, it was a seminal paper that came across my face at a time where I wasn't even studying physics. I was actually in finance. And it was the Gilles Bennett, or the Bennett Broussard, the Gilles Bennett Broussard paper on teleporting quantum states. It's a seminal paper in the field. It came out like the early 90s. And I remember, and it was, someone was writing a review on the paper and it was saying, beam me up, Scotty. Now I'm not a Trekkie, but my mother is a Trekkie. And I was like, oh, we can beam people. This is crazy. Like they're really doing this right now. And I was disappointed because you can't beam people, but you can beam information. And I understood a little bit of that paper, but I remember thinking to myself, and this was at a time where I didn't really know what I wanted to do. And I know that for several of you, you're kind of in that moment right now. Like, what do I do? What direction do I go? What research do I do? Who do I work with? What is research? I need to be doing that, you know, depending on where you are. And I remember thinking, okay, this is what I'm gonna do. It was something that grabbed me and never let go. So when you're studying and you're doing your simulations or you're in the lab at 2, 3, 4, 5 o'clock in the morning, trying to collect data, if it doesn't let you go, I think that's where you should probably be. When there really is no option to quit, right? When no matter what's going on, you really just wanna see like, what will this really do if I run this experiment this way? People speak of passion, things like that. But really, I feel like it is just an intrinsic nature and curiosity of humanity to want to know things. And for me, I want to know things at the very smallest scales. And so I am a quantum physicist. Maybe you want to learn something at the larger scales, right? So I'd say that that's my pitch, that just in the field in general, if it's grabbing you, don't let it go because you'll love it. And the more you learn about it, the more you're gonna wanna learn about it. So, like to everyone, best wishes.
Okay, so I wanna offer an opportunity for some students to ask some questions or folks from the audience in general to ask some questions. I think there's a microphone somewhere.
Yes, hi, I'm going to call on you and you can come up to the mic and ask your question. So feel free to raise hands. Did you have a question?
Hi, my name, well, that's too loud.
No, you're good.
Hi, my name is Javier Morales. I'm a grad student, second year at Princeton University. And my question is, what is your favorite type of quantum bit, qubit?
So my favorite type of quantum anything is not even a qubit, it's a qubit. So I like high dimensional quantum information where you can store more capacity per photon or a qubit, or in this case, qubit. So that's what I actually worked with in grad school, and I'm slowly but surely trying to get my company to go into qubits. And since my boss's boss is here, no, I'm teasing. But yeah, so my favorite quantum information is actually the higher dimensional states and how we map them and their unitaries or what have you based on the application. So I like high dimensional qubits.
Yeah, and I'll briefly answer, but there's like a map that comes out and it shows like each individual company and qubit type format, this, that, and the third. My postdoc is probably one of the biggest users of IBM. IBM gave me a lot of money at some point. We always love IBM, transmon qubits. Shout out to transmon qubits. We deal with photonic qubits where I'm at too. Where's Moose at? We got some experiments, bro. Yeah. But then last but not least, I am on the board of a company and their qubits are great. But if you're very interested about that, then I can't say that on behalf of State of Illinois, but we can have a side conversation.
Yeah, I mean, so there's semiconducting qubits, but you know, those are trying to marry conventional technology with qubits. And you know, whenever you try to, well, yeah, it's the old and the new, it's kind of forced together, not sure about that. And then there's atoms that can be used individually, like condensed atom qubits. Those are really, what? No, those are good. Those are great. Those are long coherence times. They're just hard to scale. So yeah, my heart lies with superconductivity. That's gonna we're gonna go the transmon.
Okay, so I'll chime in on this is because I'm actually a guy who actually makes hardware, and I keep arguing that I want to read a review called Engineering Entanglement. I think in the long run, photons got to win, right? I just think photons got to win. And so just because, I mean, we're phenomenally good at integrated photonics, we're getting better and better at doing integrated photonics and nonlinear systems. And so I just have a feeling that they're going to creep up from below. And that's just Bill's opinion. Next student.
Thank you all so much. Andrea Bryant, I'm a PhD candidate at University of Chicago in physics, and I'll be graduating in the spring. So I was just wondering if I wanted to perhaps go or switch into quantum. I'm currently doing astrophysics and planetary science. What would you recommend, like for postdocs, or maybe look into industry, doing some sort of like, I don't know, internship, or just how is that possible, or what would you all recommend?
Yeah, so I can go just briefly, but I'll let real experts talk about this. One of the things that Dr. Lally talked about is those applications of adjacent fields for quantum. But specific to your question, at Fermilab, they have one of the five Department of Energy QIS centers, and they specialize on marrying high energy physics, astrophysics, and also technologies around accelerator physics for quantum computing. And there are tons of people that are in that space that's right in the city, and I'm a member of that center. So just connect and we can figure out a very special postdoc for you, which is the Carol Parker Fellowship. Anybody know who Carol Parker is? I'm sorry, Carol Parker? It's a fellowship named after her at Fermi. There's a reason for that. You should get it.
So I wanted to add, you don't have to stand, you know, you can be comfortable. Go have a seat, be comfortable. I just wanted to add to that. So don't forget that you have transferable skills already. So when you are looking at postdocs, there are going to be perhaps some PIs or lab leaders that want to have people that already have experience in the space. But one of the things I learned that when I had first considered postdocs, I was thinking about maybe doing some fabrication because I just wanted to add that skill set to kind of my roster. And I remember speaking with a gentleman who was running a lab at a place whose name shall remain disclosed. They were doing some very interesting fabrication techniques. And he said, hey, I know you don't have experience in this, but I like to take postdocs who like to pivot, because I guess he wanted to train in a particular way. I'm not really sure. But don't think of it as, oh, I'm going from this field to this other field. If you're trained up in physics at all, and you're working in a lab or doing simulation or what have you, you have a lot of transferable skills that you can move from one field to the next. Now, you will have to spin up, and you will have to, you know, spend that time. But if you're interested, there are several postdocs out there where I would say leverage those transferable skills and show them your interest in quantum, and then move in that route. Good luck.
Just to echo Thomas, I don't think there's a field in physics that isn't touched by quantum. You know, there's space physics that has quantum, right? You're sending information to space and back. There's detectors for astronomy. There's nuclear physics is working in quantum. So every field has some quantum aspect these days that I've seen. You just have to find it.
Oh, one more quick thing. I'm sorry. You were looking for like actionable items. So one, I would say if you're looking, so start looking at various groups that maybe like the work that they do, and then perhaps reach out to the individuals that you would be a postdoc up under. So very similar to like when you're applying to kind of grad school. However, if it's something like the National Research Council or some of these maybe more national initiatives, reach out to the people directly and say, hey, this is the field I work in. I'm actually interested in this. I have these transferable skills. Can I talk to you about this? Can I talk to some people who work in your space? If you don't have the time, be persistent, and hopefully they'll respond to you and let you know what you need to do.
Okay, I'll chime in by adding one other subtle thing that sometimes students lose sight of, right? You're not a finished product, right? I mean, I always joke that my path is the most bizarre one you can have, right? I was a physicist who became an electrical engineer. Right. And I've always followed the science, and I follow the science because I do stuff because it's cool. Right. And so you shouldn't underestimate your capacity to learn anything. Right. As long as you're focused on doing that. Cool.
Hi, my name is Omna Tripathi, and I'm a sophomore in high school. And I had a few questions, which is why I'm bringing my notepad along with me. And I wanted to ask one very question that I've been questioning a lot of people about. Is what are the current challenges and open questions in the field of quantum entanglement research, particularly concerning practical applications in quantum information processing and quantum communication? And how can string theory bridge both the quantum world with general relativity?
So I want to jump into that. So Nadia mentioned that. Can you go back to the first part? So you're saying kind of the open challenges and questions, right, in the field,
yes.
And then we'll get to the string theory. So she mentioned one of the biggest things that we're consistently working on, which is maintaining coherence, right? So lack of dephasing for quantum systems at distance, at scale, right? Error correction, things like this. That is an open challenge and question that research groups are always working on, because if you can do one thing, you can always improve it and make it better, or you can find maybe just a different way to do it in general. So I'd say that's one of the biggest open challenges, is that you're trying to find out how you can have the highest fidelity, right? So the highest quality quantum information carrier, whether that's a qubit, Q-bit, whatever, of any species. And you want to make sure that whatever you send or encode, let's say if you're doing communication, arrives at the end user in the way that it was meant to be sent, right? You're not trying to lose information. So that's always an open question. To be honest with you, I am no expert in string theory at all. And I'll just leave it there. So I'm not really sure how it could connect.
Gonna start a fight with a theorist.
I was gonna think about it and then I'll say it. It's not my area.
String theory hasn't been experimentally verified. That's not disparaging it. That is not a burn. That is just saying that when you ask how something can happen, there are theories as to how it happens. But until you have experimental verification of the theories, it's still a theory, right? And saying something's a theory isn't negative, but it is a theory, right? And that's where we are with string theory still. Theory, right? In the name. Not string experiment. Not a burn.
Thomas, do you want to say something?
No.
I will follow on with Nadia in the sense that because of the structure of string theory, it doesn't really have any impact on technology development at all, right? And so for that, in that sense, it's not relevant to technology development. Go ahead.
All right, good evening. My name is Kyrie Rivers. I am a junior dual degree applied physics and aerospace engineering major at Morehouse College. And I have two quick questions for you all. My first question being, with all the advancements in the field of quantum and all the research done by everybody in this room, where do you see the field of quantum research in the next 10 years? And with the uprise of quantum computing, where do you see the limitations or the exceeds in quantum computing in the next 5 years if we successfully are able to develop working quantum computers?
So I'll take a stab at this.
Hold on. Oh. Are you saying that there are not any working quantum computers at this time? Because there are several working commercial quantum computers at this time. But if you mean just more, you know, more qubits, things like that, understood. I just want to make sure we were on the same page.
We will say it's unlikely you're going to have a quantum computer in your pocket.
Okay, we can go with that.
But to follow on, there are these 10-year challenges IBM has one, like 100 by 100 is what they're calling it. So you have 100 qubit processor and 100 of those, you network them together to solve these hard problems. I think that's gonna happen. But the difficult problem to answer, the difficult way to answer your question, or the difficulty of your question, is the fact that everything is moving so fast. Like, you go to archive right now, you type in quantum, today is Friday. It's probably 100 papers up, because it's Friday. Yeah, so like, things are moving. There's $5 billion invested. Places like China put in $30 billion. I heard somebody say the other day that if you go on GitHub, and this is where it's really gonna change. If you go on GitHub, most of the code is generated by AI, classical AI. We haven't even evolved that in the way that we want to. So 5 years could look very different, is my answer to you.
And just to, you know, to go back to the quantum computers, they exist, but they have errors. And so you'll hear terms like quantum error correction. That's a huge challenge in the field, to correct the errors, because they're coherent. They lose coherence, they make errors. You don't want your computer making any errors, because that can, you know, the difference between landing on the moon and going off into space, right? Not landing at all. So error correction, quantum repeaters are not at the stage where they can be used reliably yet, repeatedly. Quantum memory isn't there yet. So there's a host of open problems that really need to be solved at the fundamental science level. And that's what's so interesting about it. There are huge companies developing huge commercial computers at the same time that there are labs working on fundamental problems that need to go into these huge computers that are being worked on by companies. So the scale, you know, you have a breadth of scale here where individual researchers can make an impact, companies can make an impact, and that's an exciting area to be in.
Yeah, and the one thing I will add to this is that you should keep in mind that not all of these problems are problems in sorting through quantum information science. A lot of it is just fundamental material science. You know, can you design materials that have better coherence times by cleaning up all the things in them that destroy coherence? And so there's a wide variety of material, fundamental material science problems that are being driven to drive this technology forward.
All right, thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Hi, my name is Jordan Dorsey. I'm a second year physics master's student at Fisk University. And I wanted to ask the panelists their thoughts on what is like the number, or maybe kind of an order of magnitude estimate of the number of qubits that we would need in quantum computation to solve some of these kind of intractable problems like the traveling salesman problem.
So again, it depends if there are errors in your qubits or not, right? So if it's a completely error-free quantum computer, you could have 100 qubits that are completely error-free and it can solve problems that a classical computer can't. If you have errors, you might need 10,000 or, you know, 100,000 qubits. And so the scale that you need depends on the error correction, which is why I mentioned it. I think many companies are aiming for 1,000 qubit computers right now. Traveling salesman is a hard problem. It may never be solved, but a quantum computer can get to better solutions in those spheres than a classical computer can. And, you know, maybe at the 1,000 qubit level, but timescales, 20 years, 10 years, I have no idea.
Oh,
for a 1,000 qubit error-free computer?
You know,
sometime.
So I'm very particular about timelines, and I'll just be upfront with you, TLDR, I'm not gonna say a timeline. But I think because we tend to be very optimistic about these timelines, and that stuff goes out to the public. And I think everyone up here would agree that we have a service to do to the public to make sure that we are giving realistic timelines for some of these technologies. The person who asked the question just before you said like the next 5 years, things that you see in the next 5 years are stuff that's probably already being done today that's just being improved. But you're talking maybe 10, 15, 20 years, not for the 1,000 qubits, but for some of these technologies that we want to see coming online. And also you have to think about the platform, right? So Microsoft has a particular platform, IBM has a platform, Quantinuum, we have a particular platform. Everyone is talking about the quality of their qubits. So Nadia was just talking about error correction. The higher fidelity, the higher quality your qubits, the greater the error correction that you're doing. But at what expense, right? At what expense of resources in your system, of qubits in your system? So I'd say keep your ear to the ground on the fields, and you may start seeing some promising things. I don't know about qubit counts, but you may start seeing some promising things in the next decade for sure. And that's across various different organizations, academic, national lab, and industry.
Thank you so much.
Well, I think we're getting close to an hour. Maybe this will just be the last question.
My name is Eric. I'm an undergraduate at Montclair State University, junior in physics. And my question was, with the forthcoming Artemis lunar landing and other advances in like aerospace, can you foresee quantum playing a role in that? Because I know you mentioned CubeSats.
Oh yeah, I mean, the easy answer is gonna be 100% yes. Like in the way that phones are ubiquitous now, you know? There's a lot that goes into what's in your iPhone. I think people teach classes on that, right? But now it seems like newborn babies know how to use it, right? But seriously, but yeah, communications, talking back and forth, I think that's a direct line. And I can't think of much. Oh, the sensing thing too.
That's what I was gonna say. Yeah, so also sensing. So, you know, when you're landing these vehicles, when they're taking off, when they're orbiting, you are talking about tons, you know, of processors. And so now, and just in the classical sense, so now if you're putting, you know, quantum processors on satellites, right, which is something that a lot of space programs are looking into, if you are trying to find a way to synchronize landing times in real time, meaning you can get data on the quantum processor on the actual moving vehicle, so you're not having a lot of the delay that we see when we're watching like YouTube Live and we're watching these landings, right? So you have more robust feedback in time. But again, that is at the expense of what does our error correction look like for our sensing, for our processors. And to be fair, a sensor is, it's a quantum processor. It just senses things instead of doing computations, right? So same situation, which is why you'll see processors and sensors. And then communication ties it all together. So the quantum communication, right? So not just secure communication, but really just the fact that, well, it is secure communication, but not in the way that you don't want someone eavesdropping. It's just the fact that you now have this efficient, robust way of communicating in various countries, right, can trust each other with that communication, meaning that no one else can get access to like maybe their information if they're sending satellites up. That is a particular like protocol that we have not actually done at scale yet, but that's coming as well. So to your point about is quantum going to play a part? It's already playing a part. There are programs right now that are already working on implementing, not, you know, technology readiness level 1, 2, 3, but like 4, 5, 6, right? They're trying to engineer in like low Earth orbit satellites, mid Earth orbit satellites. How can we get these quantum devices on satellites? And to be fair, there are some countries that are already doing things like that, where they already have not just Singapore, but they have quantum networks up and running. They have quantum money, right? And we're not going to mention those things because of where we are. So leave that alone.
I just wanted to say quickly. So the I was going to say something crazy, but there's the reinstatement of the NQI bill. NASA is a huge part of that. There's going to be a bunch of NASA money that's related to quantum, and there's also certain centers that are well organized around attacking those funds. And I'll say it like that.
And I'd say for you, especially because you mentioned kind of spacecraft, if you were interested in working somewhere like a NASA because they're doing those things, this would be an opportune time after you apply to Quantinuum first.
And I agree with what's been said, but I want to remind you, of course, that we landed on the moon in the 1960s. Okay. And that was with If you ever visit, if you ever see the capsules that they landed in, you cannot believe that someone went in there, right? Or that yes. they did this thing. It is crazy. So again, you know, we can do certain things with older technology. The key thing is, what are we going to do next? I think that's where quantum's really going to shine, not with what we've been doing, but what we're going to do in 10 years, in 20 years, in 100 years, what you can barely even imagine now. That's where your mind should be going. What's next? Let's develop the technology now that's going to do incredible things in 50 years.
Thank you. So why don't we give our panelists a hand again? And I thank you all for your time and attention.
Thank you, Bill.
Thank you so much. So just a few announcements and housekeeping. So reminder everyone, we will be partly at the University of Tennessee Knoxville campus. So we will leave early in the morning for UT. We do have a picture scheduled, a group picture scheduled for tomorrow, so please make sure that everybody's there. And of course we have a poster session. Due to scheduling, our poster session has been moved to later in the afternoon. I think some people have asked about the poster sessions, and there should be numbers for your poster. If you have trouble finding your number, please contact me or Hume Feldman. We will be judging posters. And I think that's it, my closing remarks.
Hi everyone, please don't go anywhere. The fun part is we're about to do pictures school by school, so don't leave yet. We do. Scratch that. So we're gonna go outside. So we're gonna be outside school by school. However, I talked to AAWIP and we wanna get a photo of all the Black women who are currently in grad school pursuing PhDs and the Black women who have earned PhDs on the stage. All those schools will be called outside. So first, if you are a Black woman, African American woman, currently in graduate school, please come to the stage for a group photo. Don't be shy. You've earned it. And then after this, we'll do